Good evening, everyone, and welcome. My name is Jamie O'Regan. I'm the president of the Rutgers Club of New York City, a chartered group of the Rutgers University Alumni Association, and I thank you all for being with us today. Before I begin, I want to thank Margarita Rovenskaya, the wonderful pianist who just led us into this evening's event. Among her many accolades, she is currently receiving her doctorate of musical arts at Mason Gross, and she'll be joining us again later in the program for another performance as well as the Q&A portion. Please note all attendees have been placed on mute for the duration of this discussion, and if you have any questions, please send them via the Q&A or chat option at the bottom of your screen throughout the presentation. You can send them directly to me or to all the panelists. And following our discussion, I'll read through the questions and we will get to as many as we possibly can. Today, we're honored to have with us Jason Geary, Distinguished Professor of Music and Dean of the Mason Gross School of the Arts at Rutgers University. He has also served as Director of the University of Maryland School of Music and Associate Dean for Graduate Studies, Equity and Inclusion at University of Michigan School of Music, Theater and Dance. Dean Geary has successfully led initiatives fostering community engagement, student entrepreneurship, interdisciplinary collaboration, and greater inclusivity in the arts. He's an in-demand speaker and arts consultant and currently sits on the board for the Alliance for the Arts at Research Universities and the American Musicology Society. He has also lectured and published widely on German music and culture and has received several prestigious fellowships in support of his work, including a Fulbright grant and membership at the Institute for Advanced Study in Princeton. Dean Geary holds a degree in piano performance from the San Francisco Conservatory of Music and a PhD in musicology from Yale University. Please join me in welcoming Dean Geary.
Thank you for that lovely introduction. And thank you to you and your team and everyone at the Rutgers Foundation for setting up this evening. And thank all of you out there for being here. And for welcoming me. I'm really thrilled to be able to spend a little time with you. I want to start by asking you to think about the role that the arts play in your life. Do they bring joy, connection, diversion, contemplation, all of the above, or something else entirely? In a recent New York Times article that discussed the state of the arts amid the pandemic and proposed a kind of Works Progress Administration approach to revitalizing the arts in this country, the author began with the question of art's function, citing Aristotle's millennia-old idea that art is a kind of catharsis that allows us to see in others a reflection of our own lives. And thinking about the way in which the arts have transformed and yet endured throughout this pandemic, I'm reminded of early on in the crisis when moving videos emerged of Italians singing full-throated from balconies and windows during the initial lockdown. For me, that experience touched on another essential feature of the arts, creating a sense of community, helping us make sense of the world around us, and being a vehicle for powerful emotions, in this case, resilience and fortitude. The role of the arts in society, their role in connecting us and reminding us of our common humanity, that's my starting point as dean of a school that combines both the performing and the visual arts. So music, theater, and dance, as well as art and design and filmmaking. The question is this: how do we bring about the fullest realization of this capacity for the arts? What are the tools that students need to carry it out and be successful in a highly competitive field? And what are the values that we embrace as a school that will lead to the broadest possible impact of the arts in the process, making the world more joyful, more compassionate, and more humane? My answer to this question is the vision that I've outlined for Mason Gross School of the Arts. A vision that's built on three core pillars of collaboration, community, and inclusive excellence. In my remarks this evening, I'm going to say more about each of these pillars and also highlight some activities at Mason Gross that exemplify these values and that also give some sense of how, as a school, we've been responding to the pandemic while looking ahead to a post-COVID world. So let's start with this first pillar, collaboration. On its face, it seems obvious and straightforward, but in fact, it can be quite elusive because departments tend to turn inward to meet the imperatives within each different area to prepare competent professionals. And well, they should. Those imperatives remain, and they always will. Collaboration is not about sacrificing excellence in any way. In fact, I would argue that it's about enhancing excellence, because when you survey today's professional arts landscape, what you find is that increasingly success is defined by the ability to work across disciplinary divides and to harness the kinds of skills and insights that are gained by combining one's own expertise with the perspective of a fellow artist and collaborator. The kind of collaboration that I'm talking about would see departments across Mason Gross working together as a matter of routine. Dancers alongside visual artists, musicians working hand in hand with filmmakers, and so on. The pandemic, in fact, has actually widened the path toward this kind of exploration. An example of which I'd like to share with you now. But first, let me set the stage by taking you back to March of 2020, when faculty at Mason Gross had 1 week, just 1 week, to suddenly deliver all of our instruction online. Now, keep in mind that this is higher education, and we're not used to this pace of change. We need a committee and a task force just to change a light bulb. So you can imagine the kind of confusion, head scratching, and yes, swearing that went into this preparation. How do you teach sculpting online or jazz dance to 25 undergraduates now spread across the globe whose childhood bedrooms and parents' basements have now become their studios? And what's this thing called Zoom anyway? It's nothing short of a miracle that when all Rutgers students were sent home as a result of the initial lockdown, and after a week of spring break, that all of Mason Gross's private lessons, studio classes, ensembles, doctoral exams, juries, performances, exhibitions, and yes, even commencement moved online. What this meant was faculty, staff, and students having to learn how to use technology that literally days before was unknown to them. And I've heard testament to this effect. And I'm not just talking about logging onto Zoom and learning how to mute and unmute, but rather the painstaking process of putting together concerts made up of these squares of performers that we've grown accustomed to seeing and that require each individual student to record his or her part in isolation to a click track on headphones that keeps the beat, and then someone on the back end to put all of those tracks together to make the music that we hear. But the example that I want to share with you illustrates the collaboration across Mason Gross that I want to foster, as well as the ingenuity with which our faculty and students met the challenges posed by the pandemic. And this example actually comes from our dance department and from not too long ago, just a few months ago, in fact. The challenge here was this: how would our graduating seniors present their senior thesis without necessarily being able to use our theaters, right? Many of them were not in residence and some were not even in the country, and without the benefit of live performance, when the whole point of the thesis was to showcase what you've learned over the course of your 4 years here at Mason Gross and to prove that you were ready to launch your career as a professional dancer. Well, the answer turned out to have students working collaboratively with other Mason Gross students from theater, art and design, music, and filmmaking to create these technologically sophisticated video productions that in some cases were shot on location, outdoors, or that included animation, and that were then premiered virtually over two successive evenings this past fall. And to a larger audience, I might add, than we've ever gotten in person for this same event. So the excerpt that I'm going to share with you is from a piece called Tigris by senior Julia Foti. And she's both the performer and the choreographer that you'll see in this clip. And she collaborated in this instance with a theater student who did the lighting design, and a filmmaking student who did the cinematography and the editing. Julia tells us, by the way, that this work speaks to her experience as a Chinese person of color in the United States. So take a look. So you hopefully get some sense of the creativity and time that would have gone into such an endeavor. And the skills that these students have gained, both the artistic insight that comes from working together and the technical knowledge that sprang from the necessity to reimagine the performance itself, these skills will be critical in attaining professional success, whether that success comes in the arts or in some other field where collaboration and creativity can help them stand apart. In fact, the film that I just have shown you has already been accepted at two regional dance film festivals and was chosen by the dance faculty at Mason Gross as one of two films to represent the school at the American College Dance Association's National Screen Dance Festival in April. Now, so far the collaboration I've been talking about is across the arts, but I also envision fostering collaboration that involves the arts and other disciplines across campus. This is the unique opportunity we have being at an art school within a world-class research university. This is indeed some of the most promising new avenues of inquiry are opening up at the intersection of the arts and the sciences. An example of this sort of collaboration is our Dance and Parkinson's program at Mason Groves, which aims to help individuals with Parkinson's disease increase flexibility, strength, and overall mobility through a series of specialized dance courses that bring together the expertise of our dance faculty with researchers from the Robert Wood Johnson Medical School at Rutgers. And I'm in the process now of trying to raise funds to establish an integrated dance collaboratory, which would be an expansion of this idea and serve as a hub for interdisciplinary research, exploring dance's rehabilitative potential for individuals with not just Parkinson's, but also autism, traumatic brain injury, stroke, and cognitive decline, among other conditions. Such an initiative would be an important step toward the eventual creation of an integrated arts center that could make Rutgers a world leader in this interdisciplinary collaborative space, with Mason Groves right at the center of it all. And this is in addition to ongoing conversations with the School of Public Health, the School of Social Work, and the Rutgers Business School about collaborative possibilities. So stay tuned and feel free to reach out to me if you'd like to learn more. But let me move on and say a little bit about community, which begins with a commitment to engaging with our local community, but extends to the rest of New Jersey, to our alumni, and to professional arts organizations with whom we want our students to work, both in gaining professional skills and also in tackling challenges that we face collectively within the arts. But for now, I'll focus on community engagement and begin with that word engagement itself, which for me points to this critical idea of artists who are engaged civically and intellectually with the world around them and who understand the role that the arts have to play in tackling society's biggest challenges. So there's a social component here, and that's also related to Rutgers' mission as a public university, as a land-grant institution with a responsibility to serve the broader community of which we are a part. But there's also a practical component, and that's the valuable experience that students gain from engaging with the community through their art, entrepreneurial skills that come from having to create pathways and platforms for sharing their art in non-traditional venues, business-oriented skills related to the implementation of these ideas, and perhaps most important of all, firsthand experience of the impact that the arts can have when it comes to revitalizing communities and transforming individual lives. An example of this kind of community engagement is an initiative co-founded by a staff member in our art and design department and co-presented by Mason Groves called Windows of Understanding. Now in its fourth year, this project, which involves students from art and design, is a public art initiative that highlights social justice issues and brings awareness to community organizations in the cities of New Brunswick, as well as nearby Highland Park and Metuchen, where I happen to live and be right now. The idea is to pair visual artists with local nonprofits, asking the artists to create a work that will be displayed in a storefront or some other public space and that centers around a social justice theme like food insecurity or public health. The example I'd like to show is by Dominic Brancato, one of our newest art and design alumni, having graduated with a Bachelor of Fine Arts just this past year. So take a look at Dominic's drawing, which should be appearing on your screen here shortly. This work is called First Responders. And it comes from Dominic having been paired with the Metuchen First Aid Squad. And along with that, her efforts to learn about how their work has been impacted by the pandemic. It's currently on display at the Metuchen Public Library. And as you can see, the piece depicts two neighboring houses. I don't know how much detail you can see, but one on the left showing a party that's taking place with no masks and no social distancing, and the other on the right depicting EMTs arriving to help someone who's contracted the virus despite being in a household where everyone is wearing masks. So the broad theme is clearly public health. And the message is about the impact that our actions can have on others. A reminder, in other words, that public health depends on individual responsibility and that ultimately we are all in this together, to borrow that phrase that you've heard so much over the past year. In other cases, current art and design students worked with a food pantry and with a nonprofit that provides support to communities that have experienced traumatic events such as homicide and suicide, the latter being the third leading cause of death among people aged 15 to 24. So in these instances, the role of the arts, apart from whatever emotion might be stirred by the work itself, is advocacy for and amplification of important social messages. And in this way, the arts have a vital part to play in confronting social challenges that range anywhere from climate change to racial inequity. So let's move on and we can, I think, stop sharing the image for now. So now to my third and final pillar, what I call inclusive excellence. Embedded within this notion are two important commitments. One is the school's commitment to excellence across the board in everything that we do. In fact, from my perspective as dean, it's really a commitment to reaching that next level of excellence at Mason Groves and to finding ways to increase the school's visibility and impact across the region, nationally, and around the globe. The second commitment is to inclusivity, the notion that we need to be intentional and strategic about ensuring that Mason Groves can effectively recruit and retain a diverse faculty, staff, and student body, that its curriculum and programming is reflective of that diversity, and that all members of our community feel a sense of belonging, regardless of their background. So inclusive excellence combines these two commitments and begins with the premise that true excellence is not attainable without inclusivity. Inclusive excellence also means finding ways to dismantle the systemic racism, sexism, and other forms of bias that we know exist within higher education and also within the arts. To help with this, we've created a Mason Groves Equity, Diversity, and Inclusion Committee that's made up of faculty, staff, and soon students as well. And it's leading the effort to create for us a strategic plan along these lines that identifies clear objectives, lays out a roadmap for implementation, articulates what success looks like, and will hold us accountable from first year students all the way up to the dean. These issues also raise the question of access to the arts, right? What can we do as a school to bring the arts to underserved communities? And how can we give promising students who are underrepresented in the arts the access that they need and the opportunities to thrive? One way we're hoping to address this challenge is through the creation of a Rutgers Summer Arts Academy that would provide free teaching and mentoring to students from underserved communities across New Jersey. We've already applied for startup funding, in addition to which I'll be looking to raise funds in support of this initiative. In the meantime, our goal is to build partnerships with performing arts high schools across the state that have diverse populations of students from which we can recruit, both for our collegiate programs, but also our pre-collegiate ones, both the existing and the new pre-collegiate programs. Another opportunity I'm excited about is the recently established Rutgers Institute for the Study of Global Racial Justice, whose mandate is to use the humanities as a way of both shining a light on inequity and advancing the cause of racial justice. I've already received assurances from the center's director that the arts too will be an important part of this mission. And one of the first projects we're exploring is the possibility of expanding a documentary about Paul Robeson, created recently by our film students under the guidance of the Academy Award-winning director of our Mason Groves Documentary Film Lab. So to conclude my remarks, I want to leave you with a few thoughts about the future of the arts as they relate to the ongoing pandemic. To put it bluntly, the arts are in crisis. There's no doubt about that. Unemployment in some sectors of the arts is upwards of 50%. It's reasonable to predict that some of these arts organizations will not survive and others will have to reinvent themselves entirely. Arts venues will likely be among the last to reopen, threatening the existence of arts organizations that were already under considerable strain even before the pandemic. So no one can predict what the post-COVID arts landscape will look like, but there's reason to be optimistic. And that's because the hope is that some of the innovations necessitated by the pandemic will extend the reach of the arts across all walks of life, and in the process, strengthen their impact even more. At Mason Gross, such innovation has taken the form of not only the kind of collaborative performance I shared with you earlier, but also a host of virtual art galleries and showcases that have allowed students to disseminate their work across the globe. One such example being put up on the screen now is our theater department's design showcase. And this is a screenshot that I'm sharing with you now. This image gives you just a taste, right? Because the site itself is highly interactive, allowing you to stroll through the virtual space and take in the work of our costume design students, much as you would in a real life exhibition space. So if you have the time, you can go on our website and search the theater department and spend some time with it. It's really a lot of fun. And you can use your keyboard to look up and down and sideways and do all sorts of things and really take in the range of work that our students have produced. So I've shared with you several examples of the work that's been happening at Mason Gross and of the art making and creativity that continues even amid these difficult days. But now I want to show you firsthand, using the best way that we have under the present circumstances to enjoy the live performances that we miss so dearly. And I'm thrilled to be joined this evening by one of our doctoral students. You've already heard from her if you were here early enough. She gave us a little taste as we were all coming into the webinar. And her name is Rita Rovenskaya. And Rita has already amassed an impressive professional resume with performances at Carnegie Hall and Steinway Hall and first place medals in international competitions. She has degrees from Oberlin and NYU, and she's performed and studied all over the globe, from Israel to Germany to Italy. Now, I don't know where in the world she is right now, but I know that we're lucky to have her at Rutgers, and even luckier to have her with us here tonight. So without further ado, I'm going to turn things over to Rita and let her tell you a little bit about what she intends to play for us this evening.
Thank you so much, Dean Geary, for that introduction. I'm so honored to be here and I'm so honored to play for all of you today. Obviously there hasn't been many live performances, and the last one that I played was actually a piece that requires silence. So it's so wonderful to actually play the piano for you this time. I will be playing a piece from you by Antonín Dvořák, and it's not very well known. It's from a set of 13 poetical tone pictures that I'm currently presenting for my thesis. This is the fifth movement, and I chose it because it's possibly the most narrative piece out of all of the ones that are presented, and it translates to Selská balada, which means peasant ballad. And I think the imagery here is of a Czech countryside with many people in a pub dancing and drinking, which I hope we will be able to do soon as well. So I hope you enjoy. Thank you.
Excellent, excellent. Thank you, Rita, for that really stunning performance and very evocative, I might add. I'm sure that out there in cyberspace, there is collective applause, right? So it's one of the things you have to get used to, of course. It's a little bit like giving these talks and without being able to, of course, interact and see, you never know if a joke lands or something like that, right? But I can assure you the performance landed with me. So thank you for that. So hopefully through my remarks and through Rita's performance, you've gotten a better sense of what Mason Gross is all about and where we're headed. No doubt that along the trajectory of the future path that I've laid out for the school, there will be unexpected twists and turns. And if there's anything that this past year has taught us, it's that we need to expect the unexpected, learn to embrace a certain level of uncertainty, and be nimble enough to adapt to whatever's thrown our way. The other lesson I try to internalize goes back to the story that I shared with you about the one week that we had to pivot to online instruction. I try to imagine what the response would have been if, in the absence of a pandemic or some other crisis, I tried to pitch at a faculty meeting the idea of moving to even just 50% remote courses in, say, 2 years. I would have been laughed out of the room and would probably find myself without a job. But we were able to do it and do it successfully. So if we can harness that same spirit of ingenuity, that same level of dedication and creativity, there's no telling what the arts world and what Mason Gross might look like the next time I have the pleasure of addressing the Rutgers Club of New York City. So thank you for your time. At this point, we're gonna open the floor and I would love to hear questions and comments for either myself or for Rita about anything that you've heard this evening or anything that you haven't heard and would like to hear about. So I'm gonna turn things over to Jamie, who is going to moderate our question and answer session.
Thank you both so much. I was clapping in my living room. So thank you. Thank you for that wonderful performance. Folks, please feel free to send any questions you may have through the Q&A feature or the chat. But I have one to kick us off. And this is for both of you. Given the notes that you started off, Dean Geary, about the New York Times article that about the state of the arts and revitalization, are there any things that either of you are excited about in particular in the culture of the arts that are happening that you're seeing that the pandemic has kind of forced a hand on for folks that may be unique or dynamic or new ideas that maybe have come out of such an interesting and difficult time?
Sure, I'll jump in and then Rita, if you want to add to it, feel free. So I think there are a couple of things. They're both related though, maybe two sides of the same coin. One is, you know, I've been heartened by the way in which technology has been able to bring greater numbers of folks into the arts potentially, right? And I've seen that. I cited the example where, you know, the video that I played of the dance student and, you know, we had friends and family and alums from all over the world who were able to tune in and to experience that performance. And yes, there's something that's lost, right? We want to go back desperately to live performance. There's something about that communal experience. There's something about the humanity of that kind of a forum. But I think that we have a tremendous opportunity through using technology and through the willingness that the whole world has shown, right? Of course, the collective hands have been forced, but that willingness and also the recognition that there are certain things we wouldn't have imagined we can do virtually, and yet we've been able to do. And I think what that does is introduce opportunities then to bring different groups and communities and individuals into our conversations, right? It goes back to that notion of access that I alluded to in my remarks, right? And that coincides, the second point that I'll make, it coincides with you know, the kind of reckoning around inequity and racial issues that not just the pandemic, but certainly partly that has exposed, right? I mean, we've seen, for example, the very disproportionate effect that COVID has had on Black and Brown communities and poorer communities. And this has contributed, in addition to the killings that we witnessed over the summer and the protest that emerged from that, this has contributed to the cultural moment that we're living in and the kind of reckoning around race and inequity. And that comes at a very important moment within the arts, because that's being felt deeply. And I think that's something that has come out of this moment that's going to be on balance positive for the arts. And I see it happening at Mason Gross. I saw it before I left. You know, I've been here now 7 months. I saw it when I was at Maryland beginning to happen. So there's a kind of convergence of the opportunities that are presented by technology and also by this willingness to confront these very difficult challenges in ways that perhaps we've not in the past. And I think that convergence is a particularly exciting one for the arts. And so that's something that's grown out of this that I think will really shape what we look like moving forward and will have a positive effect. Rita, I don't know, do you want to add anything to that or anything you've noticed from your perspective?
Yeah, I would love to say something on a more personal note, and something that I've noticed just for me and for my students as well, is that along with all of these, of course we're online, but it's also opened up to much more international ways of communicating and networking. And I think that it's been really great to be able to have all these competitions that move online. We just have to send in videos, and it's this new way of communicating and being able to share our music around the world, not only with performances and competitions, but also this kind of connection through the social media that's been really interesting. And on an inclusive note, I think it's been really interesting to have this time to be able to educate ourselves and learn about composers that, aren't as well known as they should be. And it's been really fascinating to have other people who are experts about this and be able to see their work. And it's just been really interesting to have everything move online. So I wouldn't say that not everything has been negative out of it. It's been great to connect and see what opportunities come up online.
That's great. Thank you both. Yeah, to echo your point, I feel like the word that Dean Geary used before is nimble. We've all become a bit more nimble, and amazing the things and opportunities that can arise just from that simple act. To go back to some of your pillars that you mentioned, Dean Geary, earlier, one of them that was really big was on collaboration and community. And I wondered, have you thought about that in the aspect of alumni engagement, both opportunities for alumni to get more involved with Mason Gross, be it in the future, obviously when we're able to come back to campus, or support in other ways, financial, physical, whatever it may be, but also what opportunities might the school have thought of through the different various programs for how to bring alumni in, what to yield them to come back, to woo folks to come back physically to the school, because I know that's something that people are going to be longing for once that time comes.
Yeah, no, absolutely. So a few things come to mind. One is that as part of the conversations we've had, for example, around issues of equity, diversity, and inclusion in the committee that I referenced specifically, we've had conversations about the role that alumni might play on that group, and whether, for example, we want to create a specific role for alumni to play, that maybe they would have a seat or two on that committee, and could rotate. In fact, I had alumni from Mason Gross reach out to me when I sent back in the summer, and I sent a kind of introductory letter to the community, and I outlined some of the plans, and several alums reached out to me and said, look, if you're doing some of this stuff, I'd love to be involved. So I think that those are some opportunities that's maybe the low-hanging fruit. I also think there are opportunities for us to better leverage the talents of our alumni in creating networks for our current students. So, I mean, you know, every school, every university does this, they invite alumni back, but I think that we've not done as much as we could at Mason Groves. And I think that we've not always been sort of strategic about the way that we've gone about that task. And so I think that there are opportunities for us to maybe through an alumni speaker series or, you know, specifically connecting, say, you know, alumni of color with other students within Mason Groves to help those who, you know, might be hungry for a larger, wider network and mentorship. So those are some of the ways that I think we could really be utilizing our alumni more effectively than, you know, than we currently are. And I think that these present opportunities both in a virtual setting, again, thinking about how we can engage with alums who may not necessarily be in the area and might find it more difficult to get to campus, but it also, of course, presents opportunities for you know, in-person engagement once we're able to do that as well.
Thank you. Another question is, how have you been able to tackle the task of collaboration when it comes to, in particular, musical instruments? So we have video lags and using Zoom and bad internet connections. And so how have folks, in particular for orchestra or things of that nature, or even if it's live accompanying music with a physical performance, how have we been addressing that on campus in classrooms and for performances?
Yeah. So the question raises a number of important issues. And one is that when we did pivot to online learning, one of the things that became immediately apparent was that not all of our students were operating on a level playing field, right? Many of them, and you know, I think you've probably heard this if you've been, you know, reading the news and thinking about some of the challenges inherent in moving to virtual learning, but we found that many of our students did not have reliable internet. In some cases, they didn't even have a computer to work with because they had relied on the resources that we have at school, right? Our computer labs and such. So they were doing everything using their cell phones, and you can imagine how difficult that is. In fact, in response to that, we mounted a campaign with donors to get funding to provide laptops to students who didn't have computers that could run the programs that they needed, because oftentimes with our art and design students in particular, but even other students who use very sophisticated technology, they need certain kinds of you know, machinery and software and so on. So, you know, those were some of the challenges that we had to overcome. And, you know, again, students who might not have internet access, and we worked with them on kind of an individual basis to try and level that playing field to the extent we possibly could. That doesn't solve many of the underlying technological challenges, though, right? That those, you know, those exist having to do with, you know, latency and, you know, in other words, the fact that if you're listening to someone play or, you know, or perform, there's a little bit of a delay and, you know, that lag that was alluded to. And so those challenges remain. I think the technology is improving little by little. There are certain kinds of programs and software that can help with that. It's not widely available to us. It's, you know, becomes a resource question. But I will say that, you know, the level of skill with which faculty and students have interacted with technology has increased exponentially over the course of the past year or so. So, you know, we're seeing the level increase, and that's part and parcel of that overall conversation as to how do you address some of these issues. But the other thing I'll say is that the, you know, this question specifically asked about orchestra or raised that issue. And, you know, there's some areas where we really haven't come up with adequate solutions yet. And large ensembles is one of them, right? There are ways in which we can do that. We can kind of get by. But boy, when it comes to kind of the collaborative part of music making, when you think about that kind of collaborative with a small C within the context of an orchestra or, a chamber ensemble or a choir, that's hard to mimic, in a virtual setting. And so that's, a little bit of the next frontier that needs to be conquered and needs kind of technology to catch up to where we are. But, we do our best with kind of the tools we have at our disposal and the approach that I outlined in my remarks, but it's by no means, a perfect substitute, because in some of those areas like large ensembles, we're just not there yet. So those challenges remain.
Yeah, kind of getting at what Rita was alluding to before, the international connection, and I agree that if we're able to explore some sort of technology, all the doors that they may open up for collaboration in the future for folks, even when things return to a more normal state, would be wonderful. Rita, pivoting to you, I know Dean Geary told us a bit, just the highlights of your resume, but for folks who are here listening to you perform, do you have a favorite piece and or a favorite location that you've played that you could share with folks and a little bit about that experience since you've played so many and wonderful accomplished places?
A great question. Do I have a favorite piece? That's a really hard question. It changes on the week or the month, depending on my mood. Right now, of course, it's this set of 13 pieces that I'm studying. I think they're just, I've been reading about, they're by Dvorak. I've been reading about Czech history and Czech culture, which has been really fascinating. I never studied this topic in school, and it's been really cool to see how historical events shape the music the composers write later. And what elements go into that. So I'll say Dvorak for now. My favorite venue, any venue at this point. But right now, let's see. I played a really cool concert right before everything shut down. It was at the Ukrainian Museum in New York City, which is a beautiful museum. If you haven't been there, I highly recommend it. And it was a chamber music gig where I played the contemporary music of Ukrainian composers. And it was very special for me because I was born in Ukraine, but I grew up in America. So this connection was very interesting for me to hear this kind of music based on Ukrainian folk songs, but also in the space of contemporary music in this beautiful museum. So that was a really rewarding experience.
Thank you. Thank you for sharing. I think we have enough time for probably two more quick questions. So Dean Geary, for you, you mentioned some amazing projects that the school is collaborating on with other partners throughout the university, including the Dance and Parkinson's project with Robert Wood Johnson. Are there any other projects that you have kind of in the brainstorm phases or are on the horizon for down the line that you might want to tip us off to, or any interest that you know right now you just don't have the bandwidth, but it's something that you'd like to take on in the near future?
Yeah, so one of the things, I'm not sure if the question is specifically oriented toward kind of that sort of collaborative effort. So I'll just say something that I've been thinking a lot about. It's really more kind of community engagement oriented. But one of the things that I've been thinking a lot about is, again, kind of the role of not just the arts, but the artist, and thinking about ways that we could kind of embed our students, artists within communities and close to home here in New Brunswick. And I'm thinking about, if we could pair them with other students across the school and think about community revitalization and addressing issues of access, being perhaps in an underserved community, how do we sort of give youth opportunities to learn and experience the arts and new and different and meaningful ways. And so I'm kind of imagining something like a pilot program or something that would really have, kind of take the idea of an artist in residence, which we tend to think of as being something that's institutional, and redefine that within a communal context. And that's partly, I think, born out of my sense that we, you know, again, really need to think about the impact that we want our students to have and, you know, the role of the arts broadly. And so that's a direction I can see us moving in, but it's, you know, kind of going to have to wait and see where we're at with, you know, with being able to kind of, you know, be in person and interact with others. You know, I want to, while I have a moment, if I could just pick up on something that Rita mentioned a while ago, and it's kind of a theme, right? This idea of technology kind of opening up opportunities to, you know, engage internationally and with others, but also she mentioned competitions and the fact that she can now send things or do things virtually, and you know, there's a kind of willingness to that. And a kind of irony that I've been thinking about is at my previous institution, not long before the COVID crisis hit, I remember these conversations about whether we should allow applicants to the program to audition remotely, right? Either by sending something in or virtual, or, you know, not in person, right? Because the rule had been, and this is true at most, you know, most art schools and music schools in particular, that if you want to audition, you've got to go in person. And, you know, everyone was getting exercised and had very strong feelings on the, you know, the fact that students had to be in person and how could you really evaluate and you had to talk to them and so forth and so on. And, you know, one understands those feelings. But I think of the irony now of those conversations and the fact that now we have no choice. And there's such a willingness on the part of, you know, arts organizations. I've heard actors who, you know, as things are beginning to ramp up a little bit, who once were forced to audition in person now can send in, you know, there's a kind of willingness to take virtual material or, you know, to send in something they've taped online using Zoom or using their computer, or to have those readings in a virtual setting. So that's another way I think that from kind of the artist perspective, that's going to change the dynamic in the field and hopefully open up opportunities for artists from, you know, from not just around the world, but from, you know, different populations within the United States.
Well, this has been wonderful, and I want to be respectful of everyone's time. I know folks are here till 7, so I want to thank Rita and Jason both for being with us this evening. And on behalf of the Rutgers Club in New York City, I want to thank all of you for spending the past hour with us. We hope you stay connected through social media, and for anyone who wants to get more involved, please feel free to reach out. Everyone who is registered will be receiving a follow-up email with a link to this recorded program so you can share it with family and friends. And we hope to see you all again very, very soon. Thank you all. Have a great night.
Thank you so much for having us.